Indiana Jones. It's a podcast about Indiana Jones. Every movie, 1 minute at a time.
Welcome back to the Indiana Jones Minute. This is the podcast where we dismount from the film Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade 1 minute at a time. I'm Tom Taylor.
I'm Pete Mummert.
I'm Joe Christopher. Marcus is back. Porter.
Hey, he's horse sick.
But I don't know. That's next minute.
We dismounted.
Oh my god. All right, this is minute two, everybody. Minute two of Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, and it begins with John Rhys Davies' credit over a large rock balanced precariously on another rock, and it ends with a bunch of Boy Scouts, psych, fooled you, dismounting from their horses.
Is that a metaphor that we see that very precariously balanced rock when we see Sala's introduction?
No.
No, if anything, I think this movie might be a big rock sitting flat in a wide open plain of safety, and nothing is perched precariously.
Yeah.
Or you know, there are no arches called Delicate Arch or anything like that.
Yeah. So the only arch is called Thank Goodness Saul is Back. I'm excited.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good. It's called the Safe Ark. That's what we'll call it. The Safe Ark. Okay. Arc like the covenant and arc like the movie trajectory and the whole thing.
What you did.
Yeah, there you go. See what I did there. That's seeking. So wait a minute. So we have Denham Elliott and John Rhys Davies. Uh-huh. And how crazy is it that the music segues into the intro Raiders music? Like they quote, you know, the sort of approaching Chachapoyan temple music here.
Yeah.
They do?
Yes.
Wow, it's very similar.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, it's like I caught it like, you know, yay, hooray. Wait a minute. Not watching Raiders? No, so Pete, I'm not nuts, right? I mean.
No, I got that vibe.
There's
too,
like a throwback quote to the opening music from Raiders. And it got me thinking, you know, this is so familiar and Raiders-like. We're on minute two. Mm-hmm. You know, is this all to make us feel comfortable? Or is it an olive branch?
Because, I think it's both.
Okay,
yeah, it might be the same thing.
I just want to, you know, just remind everybody where we last left these people. I don't know. You know, it's a long way to Delhi. Anything can happen. And then, ha, 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 very funny. Like that. That's where we left.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So here we are, you know.
Well, Spielberg kind of famously said that this movie was an apology for Temple of Doom. So
see that I get that.
I'm on the record. I love Temple of Doom, and I feel like he took kind of like what George Lucas did after all the Jar Jar criticism. Is I think Spielberg took a lot of stuff to heart that people said about Temple of Doom, and he definitely took things in a different direction.
Right. I mean, whether or not you like Temple of Doom, and I like it fine. Mm-hmm. But if he feels, you know, that it wasn't the movie he wanted to make and stuff, that's fine. But to like use the next movie to like, I don't know, backpedal or just totally like kind of go back to your bag of tricks and pull out a lot of the same stuff. Like, again, I like this movie a lot, but when I think about that aspect of it and that philosophy behind it, it's kind of like, you might not want to remind me of Raiders that much because it's the best movie I've ever seen. And this isn't Raiders. And you're not going to do your new movie any favors by, you know, keep trying to plug it into the best movie I've ever seen.
Well, I'm just saying, here we are, minute two. We already see some very, very familiar things. That's all.
Which I'm cool with. I'm happy.
Yeah, I'm cool. It's just, it's very interesting. I'm sort of nestled, you know, maybe, you know, if they want to make me feel comfortable, I am.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I should say, like, this is actually an excellent point that I have to remind myself of. This whole idea of Last Crusade being just like, you know, a kind of rehash of Raiders, or, you know, going back to everything that worked in Raiders and just doing it again, bringing the band back together with Sala and Marcus and everything. Like, that wasn't my thinking of the movie for, you know, the last 20 years or something. Right. That's like a more recent thing of that reading of it, which I think is totally accurate, but I haven't grown up with this movie thinking like, oh, they just did Raiders again. Like, I just kind of take it as
to a degree. That's, I mean, what they did is admirable. Like, they brought back all the people we loved, all the characters we loved from Raiders, and they put them into a new adventure. And I think that's great. Like, I think, you know, and I don't like this as much as Raiders, but unlike my co-host, I support those who do. I just want to get that out of the way.
I quit.
No, but I think
my toys and going home.
I don't think, I think they missed a chance to sort of take some chances with this, but I think the fact that they brought back all these people we love, like Marcus and Sala, I think it's fantastic.
Oh, I'm never going to complain about seeing Sala or Marcus. Mm-hmm. You know, that's awesome. Where's Marion?
Yeah. Well, I want to see what happens in the movie. Yeah. See what happens.
Get your wish.
Did you guys ever think, did it ever occur to you watching this here that maybe Short Round made it to America and he's now a Boy Scout?
Oh.
If this
weren't 1912.
Well,
like,
no, you don't find that out until a little bit later. Yeah. At the end of this minute, you start out, you say, oh my God, Boy Scouts. And you know, we're literally last left with ha ha ha, very funny. So you're thinking, I mean, we don't know what to expect. That's all I'm saying. It's a blank slate, you know? We haven't even made it through all the credits, you know?
I think you should reference that in every single episode of this show just to keep us grounded. Yeah. Like, okay, that's where we were. I got this one now, though. This is good.
To keep us grounded.
Yeah. Help us hold on to our potatoes, Jerry. Yeah.
You know what? Let's be clear. Short Round would never be a Boy Scout.
No.
No.
They'd kick him out. Like, he'd be stealing from all
the kids. No. He'd kick them out.
Yeah, he would kick them out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Turn them into the Short Round Rangers or something. Completely commandeer them.
Well, then we get General Veers himself, Julian Glover.
Yeah.
Wow.
The only actor who's been in Star Wars, Indiana Jones, and James Bond.
Wow.
Yeah. He's awesome.
Yeah.
I forget his name in For Your Eyes. He's in For Your Eyes Only. Oh, the one that blows me away. If anybody watches Game of Thrones, he plays... Maester Pycelle, who's like this old, hunched, doddering, like feeble, but crafty dude. And like when I found out that it was him, I was like, you've got to be kidding. Like, he looks completely, his acts looks completely different. And it's pretty amazing. And I don't think it's just because he's a lot older now. I think that's acting. That's awesome.
Yeah, he's good at it. And he says he got the part because he was Robert Watts' next door neighbor.
Oh, really? Wow. That's funny.
And that's why. And then Robert Watts suggested that Julian's real life wife play his wife in the movie. And that ended up happening as well.
Oh, nice.
So,
did she also play General Veers' wife? And then she got cut out of Empire?
I bet she did. Yeah.
You missed Ocho Landing.
Did you notice that, I guess going back to Jerry's theme, as soon as we see Julian Glover's name, we get the shaman's bird call?
Oh, really?
Yeah. No, I did. Yeah. I did hear that. It's very familiar.
Yeah, that, I mean, that's trying to warn us.
That is one intercontinental bird.
Yeah, yeah. Or is he still pulling all the strings? Is he?
Oh, maybe.
I don't know.
Probably not.
I like that. He's still pulling all the strings. That's good. Hey, at second 12, we see what I believe to be is the La Salle Mountains. Which it's part of the Southern Rockies. Does that sound familiar, Pete?
Yeah, I was actually curious. I wasn't sure what that range was, but yeah.
Yeah. You've been to Arches, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so
it's been
have
a
I.
a long time, though.
Yeah, yeah. It was a while ago, but yeah, it, actually stunning. And I always get... It's really strange. I don't... You know, when we were taught in grade school, like I said, there are two mountain ranges in the United States. The Appalachians and the Rockies. And that's literally all I ever remembered. And I'm staring at this going, they're not in Colorado? And I had to, like, smack my sixth grade Fate. Like, you learned that wrong, Jerry.
We get River Phoenix.
Yeah. Oh, can we get
it? It's weird to think about River Phoenix.
Yeah, can we get a sad bell?
Whatever this is.
Yeah,
can we just get a sad bell for that? Easily. I saw that, and I actually got sad.
You know, actually, I saw Jerry play one time. Jerry, I saw you play at the Viper Room in L.A.
Oh,
the entire time I was at that show, I was thinking of River Phoenix, because that's where he was.
Oh, that's where he died.
Yeah, he died right outside the Viper Room. That's right. Yeah. And you know what sucks about the Viper Room is that you have to pay $15 to park there, even if you're performing there.
Oh, God.
Yeah. And it's like a way welcome to Hollywood minute. You're like, I'm playing the Viper Room. This is going to be awesome. That's a great club. It's like, you know, you literally hear, you go on at 10 p.m. No, I don't have change for a 20. Park in the corner. Just park in the corner, will you? all those places. The whiskey charged me $8 for ordering two Diet Cokes the second I got off stage.
Nice.
Like, I got off stage at a sold out show. I walk up, my Coke. Can I get a Diet Coke? That's $8. Wait a minute.
Just like in the Blues Brothers.
Yeah.
Oh, it is.
But that's what I wonder if, like, this, like, people now, like, people of a certain age, like, you know, we're in our 40s and stuff. We were like, I don't, was he older than we are? I don't even know. Like,
I think he was close to our age.
Yeah, he was really close to our age, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And yeah, he was like, who was he like by the time he died? Like, in 93, I think he died. Like, who, what actor today was he sort of like, you know, analogous to? I don't even know. I don't have an answer for this. I'm just wondering. Because he was like a young,
he was going to be Brad
cool
Pitt. Like, he was going to be the big name.
Yeah.
He was going to be the guy, I think.
He wasn't just like a cute kid.
No.
He wasn't just like a dreamboat. He was like a really good actor.
Yeah.
And kind of interesting.
Yeah, James Cameron had him pegged to be the lead in Titanic, like way back in the early days
when
he was thinking about it.
Wow.
And it's cool because Harrison Ford had worked with him in Mosquito Coast.
Yeah.
And he suggested him for this because he thought that he looked the most like Harrison Ford as a kid of anybody he'd ever met.
Yeah.
And he does. He nailed, like, so many times he nails, like, his delivery, everything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I like that he's named after the river of one of my favorite novels. He's named after the river in Siddhartha.
Oh, really?
Yeah. By Hermann Hesse.
I didn't know
that's
that.
Cool.
Yeah.
Wow.
Which is funny, just river.
Yeah.
But he's good in this,
mm-hmm.
and it's sad that he's dead.
Yeah.
But he was absolutely an inspired choice, I think, for this. Mm-hmm. Like, I think this opening scene could have been much more problematic than it is, and I think he saved it. Like, I think a lot of what makes this great is River Phoenix.
Yeah. That's true. Yeah, I didn't even think. He's so good, I didn't even think of that. I didn't even think, like, oh, boy, a young kid, Indiana Jones? I don't know. But no, he totally, that totally works.
I mean, you know, Pete, you talk about Temple of Doom taking a lot of chances, right? Uh-huh. And that's what you admire about the movie. And you know, I just mentioned how safe Last Crusade, you know, seems. We got John Rhys-Davies and the same music and blah, 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 going off to, you know, it's like, you know, oh, it's God and a whole Christian theme thing, whatever. But I'll be the first to say, showing Indiana Jones as a kid and Indiana Jones having a father, I mean, those are Hail Marys for me.
And they're two different,
you know,
guys throwing them.
Yeah.
The father was Steven Spielberg wanted. And I think Jeffrey Bohm was having trouble coming up with an opening segment that kind of, you know, like they always start with the opening segments, kind of like the end of the movie before it.
Yeah.
And you kind of get this opening scene that illuminates something about Indiana Jones, and he couldn't figure out quite what to do. And George Lucas was like, well, show him as a kid.
Which, by the way, if you sat me down and you said, you know what, it's great, we're going to open the third installment, it's going to be Indiana Jones as a kid, I'd be like, stop it. Mm-hmm. Stop it.
Yeah.
Stop it. We're coming, I'm ha 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 ha, very funny. Stop it. Like, you can't do this to me, and he can't, I don't want to know he has a father. Like, no.
Right.
Those are very, very risky choices, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think they are too.
So.
And it could be said that they don't always do the best stuff with these things that they've decided to do.
Wow.
As much as we like River Phoenix, well, there are parts of this entire opening sequence that are just absolute, but we'll get there.
Yeah, sure. Well, I just, like, if anybody has any questions, Django Fett. Jango Fett. Jango Fett. I'll just say it till I'm blue in the face and it's ha ha ha, not so funny. Jango Fett. Jango Fett. Boba Fett, he doesn't have a dad.
Stop. He's like bludgeoning us. But I think there are a couple parts of this opening that I do not like. You know, I'm sure we'll talk about those. But for the most part, I actually think it works pretty well.
I like River Phoenix.
Yeah,
I'll say that. I think he does River a real Phoenix. Good job.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And then we get the opposite end of the spectrum. Sean Connery's Professor Henry Jones.
Now, do you think that is... I get putting him last. He's obviously, it's like that trick of like, you know, this guy's obviously not the last build, but we're putting him last so we can put and it's, you know, more, it's like they did with Den O'Malley in the first one. Like, this guy is cool, so we're putting him last. Like, this is a special guy, so he goes last. But then as Professor Henry Jones, like, no one's going to go into this movie not knowing that Indiana Jones's dad is in the movie or that Sean Connery is playing him.
Yeah.
But... like, one thing I think about a lot when I think about, you know, like we were just saying, like, Indiana Jones's dad is in this movie. Like, who the hell is Indiana Jones's dad?
Yeah.
Is it a little, not a giveaway exactly, but is it, you know, to say Professor Henry Jones, like, oh, I guess Indiana Jones's dad is a professor. Like, wouldn't it be a little weirder and cooler to, like, not have any idea who Indiana Jones's dad was? Like, you know, he's Sean Connery, but, like, is he a fisherman? Is he a plumber? Is he a contractor? Like, anything.
See.
Like,
well, yeah.
He could be anything. You know, like, oh, okay, he's an academic. He's a guy. He's Indiana Jones Sr. He's, you know.
They already tricked you with the Boy Scouts. They've only got so many jokes in them.
That's right. Professor is in quotes, but you didn't realize that. You know, he's a numbers man or something. For
you
the
think
mom.
It should have said, and Sean Connery?
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, like, Sean Connery is Indy's dad.
Right, exactly. As Mr. Indiana Jones, Sir Senior Man. Yeah. Maybe. I mean, I absolutely don't care. I mean, I think it's fine. But it did make me wonder, like, well.
They do give it away pretty quickly, though, so it doesn't ruin too much suspense. Like, maybe five.
It's on the poster as you walk into the theater and stuff. Yeah.
It is interesting. George Lucas wanted this movie to be about the Holy Grail or the Fountain of Youth or something like that. And Spielberg was like, no way. Like, that's just too arcane. No one's going to get that. But then they made a deal. Spielberg said, I'll tell you what, we're going to put Indy's dad in it. And George Lucas was kind of like, So that was kind of the compromise, is we got the Holy Grail and we got Indy's dad. And interestingly, Harrison Ford saw the script and loved the idea. Like, he said he thought that was what was going to make this a great movie.
Of the dad?
Yeah, having the dad in it.
Having the dad, yeah.
Yeah.
That's weird that Spielberg would balk at the Holy Grail. Like, I mean, that's like, I'm amazed that, like, Raiders of the Lost Ark wasn't about the Holy Grail. It's like the most basic, like, what item in history do people search for? You know, like, what are people looking for for the past 1,000 years?
But I'm curious, was it in 1989, was it on people's radar like it is today? Or do we all know about it because of this movie?
Yeah, but well, I mean, who knew?
Know. He had Monty Python. He had Excalibur.
Yeah, that's
true. It was pretty ingrained.
And also, let's say,
I knew what it was.
I mean, in 1981, who's thinking about the Ark of the Covenant every morning
nobody.
At breakfast? Yeah.
Until I sat down in the theater, I thought it was about Noah's Ark. Literally. It was the only Ark I had ever heard of. I'm dead serious. Don't laugh at me.
Didn't you ever go to Sunday school?
No, actually I did. I totally went to Sunday school.
You totally went to. That's why you thought about Noah's Ark.
Yeah.
Well, so the problem, look, let's be clear. Sunday school, because I mean, I was a true dyed-in-the-wool, like, you know, private Catholic school kid. You need that Monday through Friday. You know, if you have Sunday school, it's exactly the problem. A little bit of information does damage. I mean, I'll tell you, Monday through you know, Monday through Friday information does way more damage in the long run.
Right.
Way more damage in the long run. But you know what Noah's Ark is. You know, Noah's like a good man and he builds a boat. That's what you find out at Sunday school.
Right.
Yeah. He's a good man who built a boat and something or other listened to God.
Yeah.
It's about it. Here, go make an origami giraffe, kid.
Yeah.
And it is interesting that the Holy Grail is not something that ever shows up in the Bible. I mean, it doesn't show up until the Middle Ages. So it's an interesting.
Yeah,
that's right. It has nothing to do with the Bible.
Mm-mm.
But did you say he also balked at, like, the Fountain of Youth? Like,
yeah,
he just thought really it was basic, obvious things. These are like, I don't know. My nuts?
Sometimes these have a... they feel a little Nancy Drew-ish. Or like Hardy. Well, sure. Yeah, and the, I don't know, like, for some reason the Lost Ark made sense. It wasn't something you think about all the time, but you know that it has this great historical significance. And they do a decent job explaining why it's so important and why you need to find it as this, you know, weapon of mass destruction. So,
I think we'll see what they do with how they do with the.
We'll see how they treat it.
I think we all three feel like they kind of dropped the ball a little bit with the Sankara stones.
Yes, they did drop the ball.
Well, that was just muddled.
It was, as we said, it was lazy.
And I think that's what Spielberg was kind of thinking of when he was thinking about the Fountain of Youth or the Holy Grail. Is he was like, I don't want another Sankara stone situation.
Mm-hmm. Fair enough.
Yeah,
but it's those two things are like on the list of like as a grade school kid or somebody, I would have been like, you know, okay, El Dorado, Fountain of Youth, let's say Holy Grail, you know, like just things that people seek, you know, Excalibur, you know. But all right.
A tabletop Pac-Man.
Centipede in your own home. The other half of the McDonald's scratch-off ticket that he had to win a centipede game.
Park Place. Yeah. Is that one? Like you'd see the thing in the newspaper. We'll pay $800 for Park Place. Oh, my God.
Bastards.
Hey, I got a question here. I got a big question. Can everyone please go to second 27?
Put on my slippers.
Yeah, go to second 27.
Getting out of my chair.
And watch it until second 32.
Oh, 27 to 32.
27 to 32.
I did not sign up for this, Jared.
Yes, I know.
It's madness. Okay. See a lot of rocks, a lot of dirt, some scrub. Okay.
Are you listening?
No, I wasn't. You didn't tell me to listen.
It's Jurassic Park.
No, you have to listen. I was going to say, look.
No, I have my notes. I have this is where John Williams came up with Jurassic Park.
I'm sitting here. I'm kind of angry. What happens here? We have this suspenseful, foreboding, almost sinister theme, replete with horses neighing, and it's not friendly neighing. Like it's not that. Yeah. It's like there's you know. Something ominous is, you know, imminent. Then all of a sudden at second 29, I'm flying my bicycle against the full moon hugging E.T. It kind of rips me out of the whole scene. The music there just does a complete 180.
See, I'm okay with that. I'm okay with that because I think
Pete,
it just...
sit down.
Did you listen to it? It's way.
No, I didn't listen to it just now, but it's always bugged me. Like as I listen to it, I know exactly what you're talking about. It does. A, it sounds like. Jared, do you know the soundtrack to Jurassic Park, and you haven't seen this movie? That's really weird.
Oh, that's not me. Pete said that. That's Pete.
No, I said
that's Pete.
Oh, okay.
Don't put that on me.
Cut that out.
Yeah.
It is Jurassic. If you listen to this in Jurassic Park together, you'd be like, that's the same thing.
Yeah.
No, you're right. It does sound like Jurassic Park, and Jurassic Park I was going to say exactly the opposite. I think it's John Williams kind of spinning his wheels a little bit.
Oh, my God.
And kind of like, it's another summer. We need some blockbuster music. Call up John Williams. Oh, my
God. What do you think?
I don't know.
This is Quint's lantern all over again.
I know you're not alone, Pete. Like, a lot of people are going to get mad at me. But
yeah, I need some help. It's not Christopher Dennis DeGuardia.
What do you think?
I should also, I mean, this is as good of a point to mention that the score for this movie, I can't really pick out any, like, besides the Raiders theme, I can't really, like, maybe I'll change my mind as I go along, but I'm not sitting here, like, being able to pluck out any, like, themes or rememberable parts.
Hey,
remembering doesn't work.
Tommy, I think this has some of the most memorable
Tommy,
of the
before,
series.
Yeah, before, yeah. Before you came on the line tonight,
yeah,
Pete was listening to the Last Crusade soundtrack.
Oof.
Yeah, he was doing it alone by himself.
Do you think he heard what I just said?
I think he did. I joined our little conversation here, and I heard this soaring music in the background, and it was Pete goes, "Oh, I'm just sitting in my chair, listening to the vinyl Last Crusade."
Jer, if I write you a note for Pete, will you give it to him? Like, but I'll be on my bike like halfway down the block when you give it to him. Okay, thanks.
Yeah, as long
I hate you, Tom Taylor.
No, wait a minute.
That's all true. He motherfucker was listening to the Last Crusade soundtrack by himself.
Wearing his John Williams t-shirt.
Yeah, yeah, I know.
Totally. With his, like, my other.
Yeah, I'm sitting here conducting in the air.
My other car is a Velociraptor.
Writing in his notebook over and over again, Mr. John Williams.
What hurts you, horrible, cynical people?
Having said all that, we've all had our yuck-em-ups, we've all had our laughs. I'm going to I'm just saying, I honestly don't remember any of the music from this movie, so I'm gonna keep an open mind, and if it jumps out at me, I'll let you know, because I want to be happy too.
I'm just saying we're two minutes in. And we have a couple of odd musical choices, is all I'm saying. The movie starts, like we said, with a strong Native American theme that truly goes nowhere, like zero.
Yeah, that,
like,
that'll
somebody
that'll
just
agree.
Turned the volume. Yeah, they turned the volume down 5 seconds in. And then now we have this. We have the Raiders quote, which is great. It's awesome. We're going along. Uh-huh. We even have the caw bird, right? We're feeling and then it's just a strange switch. It turns into this, like, kind of open, fanciful, whimsy.
Yeah,
big
which
landscape.
Is exactly when the camera pulls back and you get like this,
but it's
wonder-filled landscape and this majestic, open, wide open west, and you get this.
But that's not what they've been setting me up for. That's all.
Right. This could still. This same sweeping shot could still keep that sort of foreboding.
They could've. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know.
All right.
This also all reminds me of like. I mean, it's kind of obvious because it's the same year and everything. It's the same kind of setting. But like Back to the Future 3, which kind of depresses me a little bit. I think that lends to... I mean, I like Back to the Future 3. But I mean, like, just the kind of blockbuster sameness to some of this stuff kind of gets at me.
Sure.
Like, that's part of like the Jurassic Park-y kind of music reaction I'm having. Sorry, Pete. I'm just making this worse. I'm sorry.
It's okay. My eyes stopped twitching.
Tommy, I have a question for you. And Pete, none of your nice guy helping out isms.
Okay. Yeah, I'm not helping him out after that.
I'm standing alone.
Many of the arches in Arches National Park are famously named.
True.
Yes. So we see
next
we see a famous arch here. And it's in second 28. And I'm okay. Going to ask, is it A, Delicate Arch,
okay.
B, Sarlacc Pit Arch,
okay.
C, Double Arch, or D, Marching Arch, Cub Scout Arch?
SATs have taught me that the answer is usually C, so I'll say C, whatever that was. Double Arch? It's obviously Double Arch.
It's Double Arch, yes. Double Arch.
Is it really?
Yeah, no, it's Double Arch. It wasn't Sarlacc Pit Arch.
Did you set me up by putting it as C so I would pick C and get it right?
Yes, yes.
Oh, that's so nice. Thank you, Jerry. You're a pal.
So what I noticed, that's like a super, super famous shot.
Yeah.
A famous arch and a famous, one of the big, selling points. I think the biggest one being Delicate Arch. That's the famous one you see on all the Rand McNally road atlases, is Delicate Arch and Arches Park. But this is a famous one, too.
You also get the... when Sean Connery's name up, you get the famous, I think it's called the Three Gossips.
Yes.
The three tall ones.
Yeah. They were actually formed by water. Yeah. Double arch.
Wasn't everything?
Formed by water. Yeah, pretty much.
Costumes designed by Anthony Powell with Joanna Johnston. And Anthony Powell's our old buddy who designed that dress that got eaten by the elephant in Temple of Doom.
Oh, right.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Yeah.
And Joanna Johnston started out as Anthony Powell's assistant, and now she is one of the most sought-after costume designers in Hollywood, and she's worked with Spielberg on just about everything he's done. So
awesome.
Yeah.
I wonder what happened to our friend, what's her name? Deborah? Needleman?
Who
did the original Indy costume?
Yeah. That's a good question.
I wonder if she's not around anymore.
Or maybe she is. She might just not be the main costumier.
Oh, maybe.
I don't know. We get production designer Elliot Scott back from Temple of Doom.
Yeah.
And director of photography Douglas Slocum back for the third time. And I feel like since we have Nazis again, I should tell this story again. that he was filming a Nazi party rally in 1939 in Danzig, and he was filming a speech by Joseph Goebbels, and his camera started making these crazy loud screeching and snarling sounds all of a sudden. And he said Goebbels froze like right in mid-speech, and hundreds of uniformed brown shirts turned and glared at him.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah, which is fantastic. And then he went to Poland and was in Poland when the war started. And it was actually, he was riding in a train that got strafed by German airplanes, and he had to crawl underneath the plane to survive. So he's had a crazy history, kind of like Denham Elliott.
I was going to say, yeah.
But he knows his Nazis. Like he's the guy to film Nazis.
Yes, a Nazi would glare at you like
that. Yes, he's been fighting Nazis for a long, long time. So good on you, Douglas Slocum.
Awesome.
And then we get editor Michael Kahn.
Yeah.
Also a Spielberg regular. He's even doing Ready Player One.
Oh, nice.
And he's got a famous quote that I was thinking of that I want to see how this plays out. He says, scenes are always play best with three reaction shots. No more, no less. So I'm curious if we'll see that in this movie.
Yeah.
And then we get the officer raises his hand and he says, dismount. And in the script, it says, the officer in command raises his hand, halting his troops. Riders climb down from their mounts. And only now do we realize that this is a, all caps, troop of Boy Scouts. All of them about 13 years of age. The commanding, the quote unquote commanding officer is only their scoutmaster, Mr. Havelock.
Oh, my brain fell out of my head. This movie. Oh my God.
I feel bad. I'm not going to make fun of that. It's kind of cute and clever.
Here, I'll give you something to make fun of here. This might be a good time to talk about some of the earlier versions of this script, like where it could have gone.
Well, can I just quickly say before you get into that, I do not, we mentioned this last minute, I don't think that they're selling it that way in the actual finished movie.
No, I don't think they are.
I don't think, when you see that they're Boy Scouts, you're like, oh, they're Boy Scouts. It's not like,
right.
And the next one that comes up, they also, I don't think, play that way. So, but I'll see if anyone else feels that way.
Okay.
Yeah. But yeah, this could have gone a much different direction. When Lucas wrote that original 8-page treatment, they brought in Chris Columbus, who'd already written Goonies and Young Sherlock Holmes. And he started off he wrote basically a screenplay to the Lucas treatment, which...
That was the Monkey King one?
Yeah, that was the Monkey King one. And it was nuts. It has Indy battles a murderous ghost in the beginning in a haunted castle in Scotland. And then it moves on to Africa, where Indy's helping this kind of Catherine Hepburn kind of lady who's found a 200-year-old pygmy in the Fountain of Youth.
Mm-hmm.
And Indy, he's fighting Nazis, one of the Nazis has a mechanical arm. Yeah. But then somehow the Fountain of Youth is in the Garden of Immortal Peaches, and they have to eat the immortal peach.
Like I said, that's redundant. But at some point,
I've heard this Yes album.
I know. But then at some point, Indy dies, and he has to be brought back to life. And I kind of liked all this because it's like between the pygmies and him dying and coming back to life, I think they're kind of trebling down on the fever dream thing. You know, he's surrounded by these small people as he's being lowered into the ground and he comes back. He's hoping that he's of pure heart and he gets to be resurrected from the carbonite. But then we had Spielberg approach Menno Meyers, who got story credit for this, who'd already written Color Purple and Empire of the Sun. And what he wrote came a lot closer to what we have here, except at the end, Indy has to battle a demon. And his love interest is a nun named Chantal, and she's a French nun. And so at the end of the movie, a stairway opens up ascending to heaven that his dad is going to, you know, go up into heaven. And Chantal decides to stay on Earth with Indy.
Whoa.
All right.
Could have been that. And then
just like Nancy Drew.
Yep.
Yeah.
And so then they brought on Jeffrey Bohm from Lethal Weapon and several of the Lethal Weapon movies. And Spielberg called him up and said, hey, you want to get real rich? Then you should do the next Indiana Jones movie. And he did. And it's pretty close to what we have now, except it starts off in Mexico and Indy's tracking down an Aztec relic for a museum. And then finally, Spielberg did the right thing and he called up Tom Stoppard, who he'd worked with a few times before, who you probably know from Rosencrantz and Guildenstern Are Dead or Brazil, or like really famous.
Like Shakespeare in Love.
Shakespeare in Love. Yeah. And he rewrote the script under the name Barry Watson. And a lot of the great dialogue and a lot of the stuff we remember from the movie is his punching up the script.
Oh, wow.
Wow, that's interesting.
So that's kind of the circuitous path we got.
When the professionals are writing this stuff, I don't understand why they think it's okay to open up like a staircase going up into heaven. I mean, in Raiders of the Lost Ark, like, they tread, I'm not going to say lightly, but they leave enough open to the imagination. I mean, yes, the sky's open and the ark goes up to the clouds and that's it. But we just don't know what happens. That's kind of a, I guess that's kind of a, you know, a generic heaven. That's, a little Hollywood-y, heaven-y, but it's fine. You're like, I don't need to look up there. I don't know. You know, who comes up with this stuff? Indy's dead, and then we bring him back to life.
Yeah.
And you're like, the dude's just a professor.
Right.
He's just a...
No, he passed his Katra into short round just before he died.
He's just a professor. It's not, I mean, some of it gets phantasmagorical. Like just
next thing they're
going to
be
much.
Like ripping some guy's heart out of his chest. And,
Yeah, and he's still alive.
They're going to encounter aliens.
Baloney. Yeah.
It's just, I don't know. That's why, you know, they kind of, let's just say, they keep it grounded in Raiders. I mean, they bring in all the Yahweh business, and that's fine, but it's a little more subtle than, here, you're dead, eat an immortal peach.
See, I'm curious, though. Like, if we had never gotten Raiders and we were just like kind of looking back at what previous versions of a movie were. And we like, oh, and then someone opens the Ark of the Covenant and all their faces melt or this guy's head explodes or like, we'd be like, oh God, that sounds horrible. I mean,
that's entirely possible. Yeah.
It's possible that we're imagining something that would have been much different. Although I will admit that these do sound absolutely horrible.
We judge them stupid.
I guess. Yeah. The angels at Raiders are, I don't know. Stop. Don't make me say uncle.
No, I love everything about Raiders. I wonder, like, it's hard to, like, sometimes when you read a script, it's hard to envision what it actually ends up being.
Sure.
Yeah. Especially when you've got, like, something else that came out of that.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Like, if you try to picture Tom Selleck.
Kill you and not feed you an immortal peach.
My eyes twitching again, Tom.
Yeah.
It's twitching bad.
Speaking of Tom Selleck, do you guys trust that Scoutmaster? He's got a mustache and a whistle. And that there's just something about that that's disgusting.
Wait, what do you think?
He's got a mustache and a whistle. It's just...
Are you worried that like the mustache is going to interact weirdly with the whistle, or you don't like either of those things, and then he's got both of them?
First of all, the mustache is going to interact weirdly with the whistle. I just don't trust him. I don't trust him, and I do. And I think we talked about this with Tom Selleck before, and in other times. Name three people who look good in a mustache.
Tom Selleck,
Jim O'Kane.
Yes. Jim O'Kane.
There are a lot of people.
There's only one other. There's only
No. Oh, Henry Jones himself. What's his name? Sean Connery in lots of movies has a mustache and he looks great.
I would say there's
there's probably some
Freddie
others.
Mercury.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Sure. But no one else.
Raleigh Fingers.
I'm missing some obvious ones.
No.
Lots of good mustaches
I see the Scoutmaster. He's got a mustache. I don't know.
I think we should all grow mustaches for the show.
Yeah.
It's an audio podcast.
I'm starting tonight.
And I guarantee no one's going to trust you.
What about Porkins? Porkins has a mustache. Or does he have a beard? Is it a beard or just a mustache?
I don't remember. I think he just has a mustache in Raiders.
Yeah, I think you're right.
You trust Porkins. What happens at the end of the movie? I mean,
that's because of the pipe.
You guys just
it's the pipe I don't trust.
It's not the whistle.
No. To be honest, no, I don't trust this guy at all. Scoutmaster, I'm so sure. But he doesn't even know how to use that whistle or that mustache.
Oh, come on. Next.
It's a fraud. That's it. What else have we got?
That's
it. Oh, wait a minute.
Oh.
Well, there's something coming in.
Hey. You gotta be kidding me.
This just in from Professor Christy Porter. 43 arches have collapsed since 1977.
Wow,
yes.
Really?
Wow. Yes. Arches National Park. 43 arches have collapsed since 1977.
Take that, nature.
Exactly.
In your face. Yeah,
the power.
How many of those were Indiana Jones researching relics?
Yeah, exactly. Really?
Yeah. Where was he at the time?
The power of water. Na 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 na.
That's going to be Indy 5. Just runs around smashing archers.
Exactly. Yeah.
Oh, we get some crazy water scenes in Indy 4.
I don't remember anything. Yeah.
I know. I barely do.
That's going to be tough. Should we just fake our deaths? Did I already make that joke? We should fake our deaths after this one. No one will mind.
Choked on his own whistle.
Oh. Yeah, they made a joke about growing mustaches, and then they all just gagged on a whistle. No one knows what happened. That'll be a shirt. Everybody, you know what to do. Come visit us in places like Indiana Jones Minute and the Listener's Crusade, that beautiful group on Facebook where you and all your Indiana Jones Minute fan friends are chatting it up and spreading the good word. Find us on iTunes. Give us a beautiful review. If you leave us a really beautiful review, we might read it on the air because we love you guys and we love spreading your love. And where else can they go?
IndianaJonesMinute.com. You can check out all our new trading cards for the new season.
Oh, yeah. And, check us out at Patreon. Support the show over there. You'll get free bonus episodes. You'll get a sticker every month. You'll get our undying love. Go over to IndianaJonesMinute.com/Patreon and sign up over there. And we look forward to seeing you.
And if you think we fight here, just wait till you hear us on Patreon.
Oh, yeah. I got to say, those Patreon, I'm not just saying this as like a plug, but like some of those shows are some of the best stuff we've done. And because we have unearthed deep, weird misunderstandings of classic films that we've seen thousands and thousands of times.
Deep, weird antipathy between the three of us.
Well, that too. That's what that is birthed from each other. Yeah. But check us out over there. Check us out everywhere. Check us out here tomorrow for minute 3. Oh my God, we're on minute 3 already.
Can't believe it.
Minute 3 of Last Crusade here on the Indiana Jones Minute. Oh, we're supposed to say, I honest to God forget that we say stuff at the end. It's been so long.
Unbelievably awkward. One of the most awkward moments I've had with you, Tommy, since you hit me with that sword. 19.
Oh, that was beautiful. That was a real sword.
Oh my God.